So he is actively bleeding. It's awful. It's awful. Is ENT on the way?
He's behind in terms of blood volume. He's going to need a blood transfusion. I really need to get him to the operating theatre.
Nicholas, how are you feeling now? Nicholas? Nicholas?
Would you rescue me? What about myself? Would I need your love? If I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I've slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you
give? We've got a stabbing to the chest.
Oh. The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
We're going to look after you.
Royal Melbourne Hospital, Dr. Michelle Thornhill and Dr. Maya Cubitt are strategising.
I've talked Maya into doing an 8-kilometre fun run with me.
But Dr. Maya is not feeling her running partner with confidence.
Listen, I'm not running and looking behind me to pick anybody up off the track,
okay? Don't worry, I'll carry you, Maya.
No. I'll come look for you after.
She's definitely not instilling confidence, but I know if I give her a little nudge in the right direction, she'll get through.
Dr. Michelle's attention switches to an incoming air ambulance.
Royal Melbourne, go ahead.
With a badly injured quad bike rider from country Victoria on board.
Received, we'll see you in 10. You are cleared to land.
We've been told that a man that was on a quad bike has collided with a fence. He's gone over the handlebars and he's landed on his back. So, we know he may have done some damage to his neck and he's potentially injured his spine.
Helicopter just landed.
Oh, did it? Okay. Yeah. Ali is leading it and I'm helping, and trauma should be here soon. Okay.
David, a stable hand at a race course, was pinned between his quad bike and a fence. It was early morning and he wasn't found for an hour.
Okay.
It seems as though a hose on the bike got caught on the steering wheel, then caused him to lose control and crash into a fence. Really seems like one of those freak accidents that you hear about.
The 53-year-old is well-loved around the racetrack. Working with horses is his life.
I've got David here, happy for us to record and then move across to your bed.
Sounds good.
The team is protecting David's neck and spine. If he moves his head, he could be paralysed.
It could be the case where there's a broken bone that's pressing on the spinal cord, and any movement could make that a whole lot worse.
Ready, set, go. He was riding on a quad bike. He's careered into a wire fence. Now, he's gone forwards over the handlebars, but he's remained seated on the bike, so he hasn't been thrown from the bike. He was pinned in that position between the wire fence and the quad bike for between 30 minutes and an hour. It sounds like a significant hyperflexion injury of his spine.
The normal degree of bending of the neck has been exceeded, so he's gone really quickly beyond normal and bent his neck forward, which puts a lot of pressure on the spine.
All right. David, do you have any problems breathing at all?
If I take a big breath, it then yep. hurts.
Where does it hurt when you take a deep breath in?
Right across my...
Across your spine?
No, my chest.
Your chest, okay.
Concerned David may have internal injuries, Dr. Michelle uses ultrasound.
Oh, yeah. It's all on the right side right there.
Here, where the jelly is?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, it's sort of there too.
But he's really tender, that right rib cage.
soon as I put the probe on, yeah.
The hour that David spent trapped on his bike with his neck stretched beyond normal range could have caused catastrophic damage.
It's all pink and metals.
Both arms?
Both arms. Both legs. Everything.
Then we can get the public one. Okay. He's complaining of paresthesia of all four limbs.
Paresthesia is altered sensation. It is, for some people, pins and needles that you feel, or it might feel like ants crawling across your skin. What it can mean is some form of injury to the spinal cord.
Can you squeeze my fingers? Please.
Nah, we can't do it right.
For David, who lives alone with his four dogs, life as he knows it could be about to dramatically change.
Can't do that. I can't really move my legs.
If someone can't move their arms or their legs, that tells us that it's a high suspicion for a spinal cord injury. Worst case scenario, his weakness might be permanent, and he may never be able to walk again.
Senior emergency doctor Emma West is a highly respected member of the team whose larger-than-life image hangs upstairs in the staff area.
My dear friend, one of the emergency physicians, is a very talented artist. So she painted me during COVID. What I think it shows is, you know, us caring, connecting with patients. Patients were all alone during COVID. We weren't allowed to have visitors, and that was really difficult for them. And so that's when we stepped in, providing extra care and compassion for people who were all alone. And that's what I like about it. I've actually forgotten it's there. I don't know how I can forget it's there because it's enormous, but I don't look that way anymore.
Another patient needing Dr. Emma's care is arriving now in the ambulance bay.
Post-tonsillectomy bleed, 21-year-old man whose tonsils have been removed 8 days ago and ongoing bleeding. A post-tonsillectomy bleed. That actually puts me on edge because this is one of the cases that it can be life and death at any moment. Yes, I just read your note. Thank you very much. A patient can bleed to death, or they can choke to death, or it can be both.
As Trauma 2 is prepared, 21-year-old Nick is bleeding profusely from his mouth.
When the tonsils are removed, they leave a large surface area that at any point can bleed. It can be an arterial bleed, a high-pressure, high-flow bleed. And, you know, that's a life and death situation in the worst-case scenario.
Hi, Emma, we're speaking in emergency. Can I go through to the ENT ridge, please?
Dr. Emma gets blood supplies to the trauma room in case Nick has lost so much blood he needs a transfusion.
Nick looks really scared. He's really frightened. He knows what he's facing. He's bleeding heavily.
It sounds like he's just actively bleeding.
He does. He is actively bleeding.
What I want you to do is put some in your mouth. So Nick, 21 years old, had a tonsillectomy 8 days ago, started experiencing bright red, frank blood, bleeding and clots, reaching about 600 mils.
Hello, how are you? My name's Emma, I'm one of the emergency doctors. What's your name?
Nick.
Nick. The ambulance officers have let us know that at home they've seen a few cups of blood at least that Nick has coughed up, he's filled a towel. That makes me worried because he's probably behind in terms of blood volume. He's swallowing some of that blood too?
Right now.
Yeah.
As long as I don't die, I'm chilling.
They're going to look after you, okay? Mm. When someone like Nick is bleeding heavily out their throat, out their mouth, out their airway, you really have to connect with them, letting them know that you're competent, that you're going to do everything, and we're not going to let him die. So you're at about day 8 after your tonsils, right?
Day 8,
yeah. Yeah. Initially, when you've had your tonsils out, it's a diet of ice cream and jelly initially, and then towards the later stages, you're feeling more confident, and possibly that's what's happened to Nick today, that he's knocked off the scab, eating something a little bit more chunky. So some of that healing tissue will have pulled away, and that's revealed a bleeding vessel. And we've called the ear, nose and throat specialist to come in, and what we're going to do is stop that bleeding, all right? But then in the meantime, we've got everything we need to look after you, all right?
While waiting for the ear, nose and throat specialist, Dr. Emma tries ways to stem the bleeding.
We're providing clotting agents to try and stop the bleeding. He's gargling them. We're giving them intravenously. We're doing everything to try and stop that bleeding.
Amalie's ENT on the way?
Yes, they're coming in 10 minutes.
But Nick starts to go downhill. His heart is beating fast and his blood pressure is starting to drop.
What was that?
My heart. I'm crazy.
You don't feel faint or dizzy?
A little faint.
Nick looks really pale and really unwell. The next blood pressure comes up and it's 80, so that's a low blood pressure. That makes me worried. He's actually bleeding significantly, that he's going to need a blood transfusion, and we're going to need to take him to the operating theatre to stop the bleeding. We'll just get a pump set ready. Can you feel it down the back of your throat or not? OK. If we can find some ice, we're going to get you to suck on some ice. What that does is it constricts the blood vessels and stops bleeding. He's bleeding incredibly heavily and he looks awful. He looks like he's going into shock. What's happened?
So we've just had a bit of a drop in our blood pressure.
Yes.
We're still at the 500 now.
For a young person, they support their blood pressure and heart rate until right at the end they drop it. But when they drop their blood pressure, they've lost all reserve, and that's a really critical time. And that happens in young, fit men like Nick.
Nicholas, how are you feeling, mate? You want to lay on your sides? Nicholas? On three, one, two, three.
In trauma one, racetrack worker David is being checked for any spinal injuries.
Can you feel my finger here?
No, like a slight bruising.
Is this sore here?
Yeah.
David was doing maintenance at the Grampian racetrack when he became twisted and trapped on his quad bike.
Is that sore?
Yeah.
He's got right hip pain, but no obvious deformity.
All right. One, two, three.
Dr. Michelle's major concern is for neck, spinal, and even abdominal injuries.
David's inability to move his legs could be related to an injury in the pelvis.
Where about you, Bob?
Lake Fines, it's just out of stall.
Fair way.
Yeah.
David has no one who can come to be by his side at this time.
I really feel for the patients who can't have a loved one with them. They're going through what could be the worst day of their life, and it would be good if they can have, you know, that loved one there for comfort and support.
While David waits for the results of his x-rays, he's expecting the worst.
This is literally a split second thing. I just couldn't stop. I can jump off or do any type, I suppose. When I hit the fence. Paralyzed myself. But I don't know. I just don't have much movement. I'm just hoping for the best.
David's x-ray is very concerning.
That is smashed. Yeah. That doesn't look normal.
Definitely got a pubic ramus fracture.
I would think so.
Yeah.
I fear that he's broken his hip or his pelvis. If I were him, I'd be worried about what my life is going to look like after this accident.
Nicholas, I want you to lay on your side, so I want you to roll towards me.
Over in Trauma 2, 21-year-old Nick is losing consciousness after sudden, massive bleeding following a tonsillectomy 8 days ago.
If there's significant ongoing bleeding, I really need to get him to the operating theatre. I've called the ENT surgeon, they're on their way, but it's a bit of a tricky situation right now, just waiting for everything to declare itself. Is he going to bleed or is it going to stop?
You know that sicky, faint feeling you're feeling? Is that getting worse or getting better? Same. We might check a unit of blood as well. He's probably led a unit. Why don't we puncture that, put it on a warmer, and we'll start giving him some blood.
I need to start a blood transfusion to support his blood pressure. I don't want him to go into shock. I want to keep him awake and alive.
I feel really agitated.
That's all right.
Angry. I don't know why.
Yeah, no, that's part of feeling really sick. Can you feel the blood coming out now?
Mm.
No.
I feel agitated.
Nick says to me he feels like he's running on the inside. That's a feeling that I describe as akathisia, and that is that feeling, that internal agitation that you just can't get rid of. So I'm suspecting there's possibly a drug reaction.
Did he get any Maxilon or anything?
Yeah.
One of the medications we've given you can make you feel that internal agitation. I would give him some benztropine. Naz, hi.
Ear, nose and throat specialist Dr. Naz Ahmadi has to try and examine Nick in his agitated state.
He's just dropped his blood pressure. He's got blood up now too. OK, so what you're going to do is you're going to have a look in...
Have a look and then if there's active bleeding going up the theatre,
yeah. See
how we go.
Yeah.
Dr. Naz needs to look at the back of Nick's throat.
It'll take 30 seconds. See if you can count in your head as I have a quick look.
No.
OK, do you think you can do a couple
really
of seconds?
Nick's resisting. He's feeling too sick to cooperate.
Okay, next one. He's quite agitated and unsettled.
I hated it.
It's awful. It's awful. The problem for Nick is not only is he feeling awful because he's choking, but he's also dealing with this terrible adverse reaction from the Maxilon, this agitation or akathisia.
Nick's been given a reversal drug for the Maxilon, which is yet to kick in.
Whose number do you want me to call?
My mum.
How was she when this started bleeding?
She was out.
OK, and Dad?
He was out.
OK.
Dr. Emma calls Nick's mum, Susie, with an update.
Hello, how are you? We've got Nicholas here, and they're just making a plan about how to stop the bleeding. Once we've got a clear plan and we know what's coming next, we'll give you a call.
With COVID restrictions in place, Susie can't be with her son.
Yeah.
It's every parent's worst nightmare. Their son's gone into emergency and you're not there with him and you don't know what the outcome's going to be.
The risk is it'll just bleed again.
I think Nicholas will be really anxious. I just want to be there with him. I'm sure he's very nervous and probably quite distressed.
He's in good hands and we're going to look after him. Feeling any better? You look better. Settled now? Good. If Nick has uncontrolled bleeding, he's going to need to be intubated, to be put on life support, and then the area of bleeding operated on. That's, if it's needed, it's needed, but if we can avoid it, that's the best case scenario for Nick.
How will you be if we have a look?
I'm going to the stick.
Naz is really good with what she does. She's the right person to do it. And if we can't, we can't. But if you don't have to go to sleep, that's probably the best thing for you.
Is that all right? Should we try it? Do you want to test my skills?
We have the packing and adrenaline if, like, suddenly starts bleeding. And we have suture if you need it. I really need to have one good look because it changes everything. And I have to look very deep down. And I'm very well trained to use this stuff without gagging you, OK? Because I know where all your nerves and whatnot is.
21-year-old Nick had his tonsils removed 8 days ago, but today he's had a massive spontaneous bleed in his throat.
I really need to have one good look.
Ear, nose and throat specialist Dr. Naz is trying to examine him, but Nick's feeling nauseous.
Tiny bit of a drizzle of blood is still going. Then we have to go to operating theatre so I can stop it.
Dr. Naz finally persuades Nick to give it a go.
But good.
Oh,
fine. Oh, good.
Yeah, you can do it again.
You don't want to do it?
Yeah.
That's perfect. That's a really good opening. Make your tongue as floppy as you can, and I'm going to gently touch it, and you relax and breathe through your mouth, and sigh. Good one, and another sigh. There is a really big clot, but the active bleeding around it has lost. But the clot is that big, it's cute. Let's see if I can dissolve it with a bit of a gargle and spit bits of it out. And then we see what happens when we do that, if you bleed or not. If you don't bleed, we have solved the problem. If you bleed, we go to theatre. OK?
Nick's been given medication to help his nausea and he's starting to feel better.
So, what are we going to do, buddy?
No worries. It's good cold.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you think you can gargle and a spit?
I'll get you a clean one. Gross. It looks like the bleeding has momentarily stopped. It's probably a combination of some of the clotting factors he's had intravenously as well as topically through a gargle.
Ready?
Yeah.
Good gargle, like a strong one. Do you think you can clear the clot? Like a ch sound?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. How's that work? Okay, looks good.
Do I have to go into surgery to get the...
No, at the moment it's stable, so we're actually thinking we're going to get away with it.
Okay, good.
With the bleeding stabilised, Nick will stay in hospital under observation.
What if I go home and it happens again or something?
The chance of it happening again is incredibly rare.
Yeah.
Nick's looking fantastic. It's such a relief. We're just lucky, and he's lucky. It's great. How good is she?
Good.
Yeah.
Very smart.
She is.
Detailed.
Now you feel chilled, don't you?
Yeah, I'm really.
Yeah, good. So calm now, Nick.
In the ambulance bay, paramedics are arriving with a young tradie who's had a shocking work accident.
Hit the side of the head, this. Yeah, it sounds like.
Lachlan dropped a 160-kilo concrete block onto a large plank that catapulted directly into his face.
We tried to get you down into the room. Yeah.
Treating Lachlan is emergency registrar Dr. Katrina Moynihan, who's been away from her home in Ireland much longer than she intended.
When I arrived, I just actually planned on coming for 1 year, and then 1 year turned into 2 years, and almost in the blink of an eye, it's been 8.5 years. The best thing about emergency medicine for me is it's the variety. I love that every day is different. I'd be lying if I said I didn't enjoy the adrenaline rush from time to time, I think. You have to be relatively comfortable in some degree of chaos.
Hi, Lachlan, I'm Katrina. I'm one of the emergency doctors that's going to look after you, OK?
Understandably, Lachlan is really upset. What I'm trying to do is just to reassure him that he's in a safe place and that we're all here to look after him. Calming him down and just reassuring him that he's going to be okay, I think, is a really important first step.
We'll look after you. You'll be okay. All right?
This is Lachlan. Sustained a whack to his cheekbone. He's got deformity to the left side of his face and to his nose. And the pain to his left side of his neck is quite severe.
How's your pain at the moment? Where is it the worst? On your face, your neck, your head?
A mix.
A mix?
Between the side of my nose.
Yep. Yeah.
Across to my cheek.
Yeah.
Lachlan's in a lot of pain. Giving him some strong analgesia or anti-pain medication is really, really important. We want to make him comfortable and take away as much distress as possible.
Do you want to just get some fentanyl?
Yeah. Fentanyl, yeah.
We're going to give you some strong pain relief into the drip, and we're going to need to have a look at what damage has been done to your face.
Like all cases in the ED, everything is documented. It's Nurse Gemma Hodgson's turn to be scribe.
We are constantly documenting, and it might be every couple of seconds we have to write something. If the wrong information is documented, you could have medication mistakes that potentially could put the patient at risk.
That's about it, really.
I'm just going to have a little peek of... Yeah, I'm so sorry.
The catapulting plank has struck Lachlan dangerously close to his eye.
There's actually quite a bit of swelling.
One of the worst-case scenarios would be that if there was a fracture there, that the muscles that control the movement of the eye can get entrapped. And that would mean that Lachlan's eye would no longer be able to move normally.
And just a little bright light, OK? Good job. That left eye, Lachlan, can you see out of it?
No, they're not lining up anymore.
Yeah.
Lachlan tells me that his vision from his left eye isn't normal. I'm really concerned about what that could mean for Lachlan.
In Trauma One, Dr. Michelle is worried racetrack worker David has spinal injuries after a freak accident on his quad bike.
Jingling.
David has lost all sensation in his limbs and is heading to CT.
Very interesting.
The scans are not what Dr. Michelle was expecting.
It looks like there's an injury in his hips, but the CT doesn't match. It actually looks normal there.
On the first look at his pelvic X-ray, it seems as though there could be a fracture on the right side of his hip. I'm surprised when I see his CT scan and he doesn't have any fractures.
So the team goes back for another look at the X-rays.
That looks like a pelvic bone strap that was actually...
That's what I'm saying, maybe it's a bit of external artifact that's...
Yeah.
But some of the contour just doesn't look right. Yeah.
Sometimes there could be some external things that shadow or form artifact, and it's hard to tell the difference.
David doesn't have a life-threatening pelvic injury, but he'll need further tests to explain the loss of sensation he's experiencing in his limbs.
David does show quite a bit of swelling to his spinal cord and quite a bit of injury to the ligaments around the cord as well.
The fact that you're having the pins and needles and the numbness and the weakness is concerning for an injury to the spine. So you'll still need to have an MRI scan that'll better show us the spinal cord, okay?
His spine needs to be stabilized.
Really important now is just you lie nice and still, don't try to move. If you need anything, just sing out and let us know, okay?
Emergency doctor George Plunkett is responding to a call for a patient with a serious heart condition. 52-year-old Antonio has come into the ED with severe heart palpitations.
So Antonio's come in because he's felt the unusual fluttering in his chest that he knows is his atrial fibrillation. That's a short-circuiting rhythm that can happen in your heart that produces an irregular heartbeat, and it feels a bit like they've got a bird flapping about in their chest.
Hello. How are you going?
Really anxious.
That's okay. I'd be anxious.
I haven't had this for over 11 years, but it's sort of decided to come back.
Dr. George decides that Antonio needs immediate action to fix his heart, a cardioversion.
We're going to put a couple of little fancy adhesive patches on his chest and we're going to electrocute his chest.
They're going to do this to me about 15 years ago. They got everything ready and that's what they did it, I
regret it. I imagine it is pretty intimidating to hear that they're going to have an electrical current pass through their chest so that, you know, their heart rhythm will restart.
We're doing this because leaving your atrial fibrillation increases your stroke risk.
Yep.
People have previously been shocked into other funny rhythms and needed another shock.
So I'll just be asleep, I won't feel it.
Yeah, exactly. So you'll be drifting off to sleep, no memory, zap, and then you'll wake up and go, oh, what's going on? Well, so do you want to do one?
Yeah.
We'll get another doctor together because this is a two-doctor, two-nurse kind of procedure.
With Antonio's permission, emergency registrar Dr. Rosie Parker will perform the cardioversion under Dr. George's guidance. This will be the first time she's used this cardioversion machine.
I'll point out how every machine's different, but they all follow the same kind of concept, because they want to make it easy for when people are freaking out, you know, one, two, three. It even tells you what order to go through.
Rosie's one of my junior registrars. There are a number of core procedures that we'd expect them to be expert at by the time they finish their training program. This is absolutely one of those. But it's one thing for me to expect it, and it's another thing for me to know it. And so getting her to demonstrate a safe technique is good for both of us.
All makes sense. Yeah. Excellent. Now, in a tick, I'm going to start giving you some medication that's going to just start drifting you off. And we won't do anything until you're asleep, I promise.
The medication is slowly going into his bloodstream.
Zero at the moment. I'm just trying to get it in.
You know, all their blood vessels are being squeezed. You know, their body's going through a really, an acutely scary moment.
Why don't you just have a little relax? Don't even close your eyes. We'll get you off to sleep shortly.
And so for Antonio, I was just having trouble actually squeezing the medication through the drip.
How are we going there, my friend? Oh, so I think that's hit the spot. So.
With Antonio finally off to sleep, Dr. Rosie and Dr. George are ready to shock his heart.
Now, you see you're at 200 joules, so you want your energy level down?
It only takes seconds to deliver the shock, but Dr. Rosie must deliver it at a precise moment. If not, it could be fatal.
We need to be careful that we deliver this electrical shock at the right part of the cardiac cycle.
Look for the sync button, find that one for me.
If we deliver it at the wrong part of the cardiac cycle, they'll go into fibrillating rhythm, and that's extremely bad, much worse than atrial fibrillation. Instant cardiac arrest.
Are you ready?
In the Royal Melbourne Hospital Emergency Department, 52-year-old father of two Antonio is about to be given an electric shock to correct his faulty heart rhythm.
Okay. So, you're happy?
It's the first time Registrar Dr. Rosie has used this machine to perform a cardioversion.
Now, you see you're at 200 joules, so you want your energy level down. Hit it again. I'm happy.
Yes, okay. Ready? Shocking now.
Sounds very regular, doesn't it?
The electric shock works. The dairy company manager's heart has gone back into a normal rhythm.
I'll let you do your ECG before I try wake him up. Oh, too late, he's already waking up. Hello! Wakey wakey. How are you feeling? A bit tired.
Very, very tired.
Yeah, drowsy's okay. All fixed. Heart's back into a normal rhythm.
You did the procedure?
Totally, already done. You've been asleep for about, I don't know, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes?
And no AF.
No AF.
Awesome.
Awesome, that's what I like to hear.
Dr. Rosie's cardioversion was a great success.
Rosie was just fine. She was safe. She was competent.
That was amazing.
Oh, glad to hear it. Getting rave reviews.
He's DCR'd now, so he's just post-anesthetic recovery. He woke up and said, that's amazing.
No one knows what causes AF. It's a topic of ongoing research.
Hopefully it doesn't come back anytime soon, but it could. But, yeah, we'll see how we go. But I might take this machine home and do it at home, I think.
You've got a lot of blood on your hands, but I'm pretty sure that's all come from your face.
Across the corridor, tradie Lachlan has shocking facial injuries after being struck in the face by a plank at work.
All right, I know.
His left eye took much of the impact.
What were the pupils?
They're like a two, a bit sluggish.
So biggest concern, obviously, with his potential eye injury is that he actually may lose or have impaired vision, which, being a young tradie, obviously, can be life-changing.
I'm just going to change to a rigid collar. You don't have to do anything and I'll be holding your head, OK?
Oh.
And in spite of strong pain relief, Lachlan is still in agony.
Any difference with the pain relief that I gave you, or...?
Oh, it sucks.
It's going to give him a bit more fentanyl, Katrina.
Yeah, thanks.
Another 25, Nash?
Another 25, yeah.
I've just got to document the last two.
Nurse Gemma is keeping on top of all the medications Lachlan is receiving.
Lachlan's had quite a lot of pain relief already with the paramedics. We need to make sure that we're not giving an excessive amount. Is it 75 he's had?
Yeah.
All right, all your fentanyl's up to date.
That ears are ringing like...
Can I just have a very quick look in his ears?
The strike and the ringing in his ears is a warning sign to Dr. Katrina.
I'm just having a look in this ear. I'm going to do the same on the other side, OK?
My immediate concern, there's something going on that's more significant and more serious that we can't appreciate just on first look.
You said your hearing is bad on the other side.
It is ringing on both sides.
OK, all right. And you didn't fall backwards, did you, when the wood hit you? Did you stay standing up?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Do your best to relax. You're OK.
If a person sustains damage to their brain as a result of a trauma, then they certainly can have a seizure disorder as a result of that, and potentially that could continue long term.
We're going to need to arrange some scans for you, OK? Do you feel nauseous right now?
Not particularly.
No. If you start to feel nauseous, so just let us know early, OK? Do you live by yourself or...?
No, my dad.
With your dad, OK. Does your dad know that you're here? Do you want me to give him a call?
He knows.
He knows, OK. No trouble, no trouble.
Lachlan's dad is rushing to be by his son's side as he heads to CT. While being scanned, Lachlan takes a turn for the worse. It's a dangerous situation. Lachlan could choke because he's on his back and unable to move.
Are you all right, Lachlan?
In CT, tradie Lachlan is in danger of choking as nausea overwhelms him.
Are you all right, Lachlan?
The team has only moments to move him onto his side.
The vomiting in the CT scanner is potentially due to the impact that he's had to his head, and also the strong pain relief that Lachlan has required. Unfortunately, the side effects of those medications is nausea and vomiting.
Lachlan is now safe to go into the CT, with Dr. Katrina monitoring the results.
He's sustained a fracture to his left cheekbone, to the bones in his nose, and also the socket that supports the eye. Lachlan is going to need surgery to stabilize those fractures. I think overall he's been incredibly lucky to not have sustained any more significant life-threatening injuries.
How are you going?
Really anxious.
Dairy company manager Antonio arrived at the emergency department with his heart racing from atrial fibrillation.
I haven't had this for over 11 years.
Why don't you just have a little relax?
To get Antonio's heart back into a normal rhythm, Dr. George needed to give him an electric shock. Antonio's cardioversion was successful and took only a few minutes.
How are you feeling?
Is this a
procedure? Totally, already done.
For some people, you know, you'll shock them back to a normal rhythm and they'll stay that way for 5 seconds and go back into atrial fibrillation. For some, like Antonio, they'll go back into normal rhythm and stay there for a decade or two. And that's just something we'll have to wait and see.
But for now, Antonio is happy to be heading home with a normal heartbeat.
21-year-old man whose tonsils have been removed and ongoing bleeding.
Dr. Emma's patient, Nick, arrived by ambulance with heavy bleeding from his throat after a tonsillectomy.
What's your name?
Nick.
Nick.
Nicholas was in a critical condition.
Because it sounds like he's just actively bleeding, isn't
he? He is actively bleeding.
Dr. Emma was concerned he could bleed to death as his blood pressure plummeted.
Nicholas?
8 weeks later, Nick has put the frightening incident behind him.
It was a very scary experience. The emergency crew and all the doctors and nurses were brilliant. They were amazing. Feeling much, much better now. It's good to be home.
It was a good thing Nick followed his instincts the night the bleeding started.
I actually discussed with my friend. I was thinking, is this enough blood to call 000? And then I felt it coming more and more and more. And then we thought, yeah, definitely call 000.
With the life-threatening incident behind him, Nick is back to normal life, shooting hoops and enjoying his family. Tradie Lachlan arrived at the Royal Melbourne in agony after a freak accident on a construction site.
Hit the side of the head very close to the left.
We'll look after you. You'll be okay, all right?
As well as dealing with his extreme pain, emergency doctor Katrina was concerned for Lachlan's eye, only centimetres away from the massive impact.
That left eye, Lachlan, can you see out of it?
No, they're not lining up anymore.
Yeah.
After a night of rest and pain management, Lachlan is already feeling a lot better. The accident happened just before work stopped for the day on the building site.
He's carrying a concrete sleeper, I weigh about 160 kilos with another guy, and I accidentally dropped it on top of a piece of timber and flicked up and hit me straight in the side of the head. Took me off my feet.
Lachlan's recovery will continue over a period of weeks, so we know that he will have to have surgery to fix that fracture to the left side of his cheekbone. But all going well, I would expect Lachlan to make a full recovery.
With his surgery still a week away, Lachlan's looking forward to some TLC from his mum.
I think my mum will probably come and pick me up. I'll just chill at home, Panadol, put some ice on my face. Hopefully the swelling will go down quick so I can get in and get it fixed and look pretty again.
Dr. Michelle's patient, David, was at risk of permanent spinal cord damage after a quad bike accident at a country racetrack.
He's careered into a wire fence.
David's neck was flexed far beyond its natural limit, and he faced the terrifying prospect of being paralysed.
Stop this leg.
I can't really move my legs.
Paralysed myself.
You'll still need to have an MRI scan. That'll better show us the spinal cord, OK?
David's MRI does show some injury to his spinal cord. He is put into what's known as a halo so that he won't be able to move around while his spine heals.
David spent a challenging 8 weeks in hospital before finally going home.
It's absolutely great to be out of the city. Out here, I literally hear the kangaroos munching on the grass.
When he was last here, David had no idea what was just around the corner.
The morning of the accident, I was just doing my usual job, was clearing the irrigation pipes off the training track, and I was just on the quad bike and dragging it along, and piping happened to get caught up in the accelerator cable and the handlebars and took control of the bike. It was propelled forward and stuck on top of the bike with my head in the fence, and knew I was in a bit of trouble then. I couldn't move, I couldn't get myself off the bike.
David will never forget what the staff at the Royal Melbourne did for him, nor the experience of arriving at the emergency department.
I was terrified when I first got there. I didn't know where I was ever going to walk again. The staff at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, the doctors, the nurses, were just unbelievable. I will be forever in their debt.
David's well on the road to recovery, and he can't wait to get back to doing what he loves best.
I think I can say once I can lead a horse back in around the mounting yard and lead the jockey up for the races. Once I can do that by myself, I know that my recovery will be complete.
But there's one form of transport he's done with for good.
I don't ever want to see a quad bike again, and I certainly will never be riding one.